some profound information coming to us, we could have some questions and answers.
Be profound, stop scrolling around.
Okay. I should introduce everybody. This is Bill Keyser, George Wegman, Paul Brandwein, Monacelli, and Ed Buscemi. All right, guys.
Okay. All right, welcome everybody. We didn't really plan anything in particular, but anyway, let's move along here. Zan put the show together, and Zan has kind of brought us all here to talk. We are a group that meets weekly. We have been meeting at Mise and Place for a couple of years now.
About 2 years.
Yeah, 2 years at least. We've lost that location. The owner decided, I guess he wants a life, so we shut it down. We're continuing to meet. It's been a very special get together every week. We have a lot in common and really enjoy the fellowship, conversation. Much of it does center around art, talking about art, and then other issues. So anyway, I think the idea here is for each of us to say a little something about ourselves and about our work. Again, my name's Ed Buscemi. I grew up locally, was raised in Fairport. Born in 1946, raised during the 50s, a wonderful time to, I guess, to exist, honestly. It was, in many ways, it was really like the happy days. America was on top, and in fact, I remember watching a documentary one time that stated the fact, that is that 3 out of every 4 cars in the world were owned by Americans. Now, some people might find that offensive, but all I'm trying to say is that it was a very prosperous time. In fact, I remember when I was first beginning to work, how you could quit a job one day and get another one the next. So in fact, that was part of my downfall. Anyway, high school, I studied art, grammar school and so forth. Didn't really give much thought to what I was going to do to make a living. When I got out of high school, I was supposed to go to New York City to study commercial art. That's what they called it back then. And in fact, back then, and I'm talking 1964, there really weren't a whole lot of options for someone with art ability coming out of a working class family. I wanted to go to RIT, but couldn't begin to afford the tuition. I chickened out going down to New York. Just this small town kid, worked a year at a factory and knew pretty quickly I wasn't going to do that. It was really a tough job. Went to MCC, and one of my first classes there met George and Peter. In fact, it was an Art Essentials class that was 50 years ago. We formed a bond that has continued to this day. It has lasted. Anyway, I'll continue real quickly with my life. I don't want to take too long with my life. I survived the 60s, barely. Got into the whole kind of hippie culture. Never really gave much thought of what I was going to do to make a living. I was in and out of school. Barely survived the draft. And that's a whole story, you know, alone by itself. It was a scary time. If you flunked out of school, which I did, they were going to draft you and send you to the rice paddies of Vietnam. No joke. No joke. It was pretty weird. Got married in 1971. My wonderful wife has supported me all these years. Stayed with me. She's amazing. We raised 4 children. I have 8 grandchildren with a 9th on the way. They have been scattered all over the place. In fact, I used to complain about living in Rochester, but as a result of visiting kids and traveling and so forth, I have come to not mind it so much. We don't have tsunamis, hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes. Wildfires, mudslides, really, bears.
Snow.
We just have a winter that is a little bit longer than I would like. We don't have, oh, by the way, we don't have intolerable rush hour traffic,
no.
Which I've certainly seen in my travels, so it's really not a bad place to live, including the fact that there is a vibrant arts culture, arts community, and it's been quite wonderful. Anyway, I worked 20 years in the graphic design marketing field. Prior to that, I worked a string of crummy jobs trying to figure out what the H I was going to do with my life and how I was going to make a living. Factory jobs, delivery jobs, a variety of things. Eventually was able to learn enough to break into the graphic design field at a base level, work my way up so that eventually I had a pretty decent job working in the marketing department. Did a lot of cool stuff, travels, lots of neat projects and so forth. I absolutely hated it and ended up in therapy, to tell you the truth. I always wanted to teach, didn't plan my life well enough to be ready to do that. Eventually I got laid off, 1997, praise the Lord. took a couple of years, but went back to school, went to RIT, worked on my MFA, and in fact at that time, I met Bill Keyser, and we've remained friends ever since 2000. So 2000, 2002, studied for my MFA in painting and printmaking, began teaching immediately, and I have taught since then. Taught 10 years full time for the Art Institute of Pittsburgh. In November last year, I got cut back to adjunct, praise the Lord, because it was getting too much. Too much. And now I teach maybe one class a session. I go out to the a federal detention facility in Batavia once a week to teach inmates or to teach art to inmates that are being detained by the Department of Homeland Security. They come from all over the world. Not all of them even speak English. So I'm really having a wonderful time. So I brought some of my art. I won't show that now, but here we go. There is Peter Monacelli.
Wow. I don't really need this. That's a hard act to follow. Anyways, we all, Ed, George and I met in 1967, and I had studied industrial chemistry in Buffalo, New York, and someone thought that I had the aptitude for industrial chemistry, and this microphone has more aptitude for industrial chemistry than me. And so I worked in the field too. I mean, I can't believe I did, but I did. And what happened is in 1967, I was selling life insurance in Akron, New York. I did play in a rock and roll band, which is the only thing that was saving my life, was going and playing gigs on weekends, because it was something that was creative. And I thought, if this is all there is, just kill me now. I mean, it's like, you know, I had a little kid, and it was like, this can't be what life is about. So I went to Buff State, and I took an entrance exam, and they said, you can't come here. What happened to you? You know what I mean? You're the dumbest, no. And so they said, but there's a little community college in Rochester, New York, called Monroe Community College. So we moved from Akron to Albion, New York, west of here, and I went to Monroe Community College, and I met him and him. And we had this, he was 17, he was 19, and I was 26. And one time, we all had lunch in the basement. And there was an Arab, a Palestinian Arab, Ibrahim, who was our friend. And there was a Jew, Jack Disraeli. And the five of us would have lunch every day and fight like dogs over the table for all the political stuff that was going on. It was 1967, you know, and with the Vietnam was going on and all hell was breaking loose. And I was coming down the back stairs at MCC, and Jack Clements was our teacher. He was 47, and he just had got his MFA. He had been a surveyor for the state of New York for 20 years. And his thesis show was in this stairwell. And I went there, and I was coming down the stairs, and there it was. And I had no place in my reality to put it. My reality was about this way. But I knew one thing. I mean, I didn't know what, I never saw a real painting in my life. I knew one thing, that was me. And I had been painting ever since. And hanging out with these guys ever since. And we've ended up getting married, having kids, having grandkids, and all of us, you know, I mean, life went on. At our 40th anniversary of knowing each other, we had a show at MCC that was really about the most fun. Margot McCauley was part of our group also, and Jack Clements had 10 people in that class. One went on to get a PhD in art history. He's got an MFA from RIT. He's got an MFA from RIT. Margot McCauley has a master's degree in art education from Nazareth in Maine. Now, I don't have an MFA. I have a BFA because I worked with Kurt Feuerherr. He was my mentor. And I never stopped making things. I've been making things ever since. And I also never got out of MCC. I tell my students, don't think I'm smart, because I've been here since 1967 and I still can't get the hell out of the way. I'm trying, but it doesn't work.
They put you in the hall of fame.
Yeah, right. They said, if you're going to keep doing this, you know what I mean? I also was fortunate enough to have a construction company, and I did the little theaters, all of them. I renovated one. I did 2 and 3 in 83. I did 4 or 5 in the cafe in 94. Bill Coppert and I, we were very close friends and did a lot of things together. I was the art curator here before Zan for a long time, and before Kathy Farrell, she was the second one. Zan is doing it now. And this place is a cultural center in Rochester, as far as I'm concerned. It has everything. Music, movies, art, food, beer. God is proof. Benjamin Franklin said beer is proof that God loves us and wants us to be happy. And as far as, you know, I'm not going to necessarily talk about making art, what we make, but I'm still teaching at MCC, and I just, you know, it changed my entire life to go to that little funky place. All of us, I mean, the three of us, you know, no matter, it's the Statue of Liberty of education in this county, in this community. I can't imagine what this community would be like if it didn't have MCC. I appreciate all the other institutions, but people that go there know what they're going to do. He's the only one that did art in high school. I never did art. I don't know if you did. No, he was a musician too, by the way. Rock and we were all hung up on rock and roll at the time. But I'm going to let him tell that story. So, anyways, thank
you.
You haven't talked about
the art yet.
I haven't, and I'm probably not going to, but I, you know, extinction, I'll just tell you what extinction means. Ending. And you know what? I had a friend that worked for me that I met last September. And he said to me, he's dying. He needs a heart transplant, and he needs a kidney transplant. And he's over 55, so they can't do both. So Mike said to me, you know, I was raised a Catholic. And if they're right, I'm going to see my mother and father again. And if they're not, it won't matter. And that's what extinction means. So my escaping extinction pieces are really about how difficult it is to escape anything and how it's impossible not to become extinct. With that, I give it to Paul Brandwein.
Thank you.
Go ahead, cover that.
I guess I'm kind of the odd man out here. I don't have much of a connection to RIT or MCC. I only came to Rochester in 1980. I'm kind of a late bloomer. After failing as a crafts businessman, art businessman, I decided to get into teaching, and I taught for 28 years at Rochester City School District, teaching art, attempting to teach art, and I just. I knew George from when our kids were real young, and just one day in this past spring, I ran into George up on Cobbs Hill, and he mentioned this group. So that's how I got involved in this group, and it's great because usually I. I'm not really, never really feel like I'm a part of any group. I always felt kind of like alien. And this is like the only group that I've ever really felt like that accepts me. So, you have really low standards.
We just want to let you know that.
Paul, you haven't voted yet. That's right.
Oh, oh God! So, early on in my career, my work was mostly about sculpture, about form, and it was only a little bit later that I started getting into color. I guess when I was running my craft business, I decided to I'd make ceramic jewelry. I mean, surely people would want to buy ceramic jewelry. So I got into all the underglazes and the lusters and everything with that. And when I could afford a bigger kiln, then I started making real fanciful anthropomorphic things and using lots of bright underglazes on those. But I really didn't think of myself as a painter. It was only, you know, while I was teaching in the school district, and I would have a little bit of time to work in my studio, that I started to work on paintings, because I figured, well, I start something in clay, it's gonna dry up before I can finish the damn thing. So, but if I make something out of paint, I can always come back to it. And now, last few years, I'd have to say that most of my concern is with color. And the pieces that I have here in the show, I guess the connection between this and my sculptural work is that in both cases, I've been really interested in what the material can do. What can I get the clay to do that the clay wants to do? The clay wants to fold, and the surface wants to stretch and crack in interesting ways. And I always wanted to make the clay look like it hadn't been touched by a human hand. It was organic, that it kind of grew. And with the paint, I've gotten so that I really wanted to see, well, what can the paint do when it drips? And lately, the more recent pieces, I've been taking a little plastic atomizer, about this big, and spritzing real thin paint out and letting it fall on the surface, and to see what happens when I layer one color onto another. As I work on these things and create these rich surfaces, I look at them for a while, and then I say, well, this looks like maybe this kind of a shape here, and these things sort of grow out of it. Any questions?
Yeah.
Good. I would like to mention that two of our group are not here. Bob Tongi has just gone in for surgery, and then Kurt Furheim, 93 years old, is just...
will be in March, right?
It will be in March. He just left to attend a birthday party with a friend that's 92. So he's off partying.
George, and I have the distinction amongst this group of being the only non-teacher, and for the life of me, I don't know why they let me hang out with them, but at the same time, I've become a very good student in my years, and I think that's what I get most out of the group, is that they're constantly teaching me something. Even though I've been working for like 50 years at painting, the thing that has become most obvious to me is that it's a constant search and trying to learn more about yourself and what you want to say and how you want to say it. I also have no experience in speaking in front of a group, and it's probably the least favorite thing I like to do. As far as being, whereas my past, I, you know, grew up as one of 11 children. So you learned how to occupy your alone time, and what do you want to do? It became pretty rare that in order to find any kind of identity in a group, that you have to seek out that space.
George, can you speak up?
My voice doesn't allow me too much, but maybe we can help with the other
part. That's good.
But what I was saying is that, you know, this being part of a large family is that everything was kind of a collective thing, and you had to find out where your own space was. And then when you got to that space, what do you do in it? And I always found that I was inclined to seek out some kind of creative activity. And it took many different forms throughout the years. So it's a real avenue. A lot of car builder for many years. And that kind of got me indirectly into drawing, because I started to get very interested in drawing concepts, you know, things that I wanted to build, and entertaining kind of wild creations and things. Well, following that, I became very interested in music and what contemporary music that was being played at the time, mostly rock and roll, and taught myself how to play very amateur guitar, which I still continue to do to this day, but I still find enjoyment out of it, and it's just another area that can explore and kind of stretch, not to be satisfied with where I was, or I don't know where it would ever go, but it's the same thing with the art, is that I never had a distinct style. My art has always been a search, and if that exploration ever stops, it's going to be the day that I hang up the brushes. Is that I really like not knowing where the next thing is going to be, or I don't want my art to be conclusive in that way. So you'll see within my art, there's many a diversity of styles, there's a diversity of materials, but that's part of the exploration that I like, and it's my journey as an artist. I don't know what else to say. I was 26 years working at St. John's Nursing Home. I as a carpenter and, well, I've been almost 40 years working as a carpenter before I retired. In that profession, I'll still take on some side jobs now and then, but the thing that not only carpentry, I mean, it's a wonderful profession to be in, is to be able to realize in another way, in a creative way, what you want to make and building it, figuring out how to get it done. But it also taught me the discipline of holding another job and always finding time for your creative spirit. And, you know, I just think that was a lesson that I learned and that I tried to put into practice all my life. So I really have nothing further to say right now. I turn it over to Bill, who's a much better public speaker.
Bill, wait 1 second. I want to say this much, that probably the three of us, George, Eddie, and I, one of the things that we were able to accomplish, because we all did something. Now, Ed did work in the art field, but we still, George and I, the three of us, could still keep everything we were doing as what we wanted to do, rather than what the art world would drive us to do, or would demand from us to do. There is good things in that and bad things in that, but the good things in that is that as our lives are coming to a close, I mean, some people would think that our lives, there are more of our lives in back of us than in front of us, let's put it that way. That what happens is that we have been able to absolutely explore, like you said, all these things that whatever came up, we could explore. We were never pressured to keep making the same paintings because they were selling for a lot of money and all that crap. And that is a good thing, I think. I think our lives, even though we had to do something else to make a living, our lives still, and teaching is a different thing than making art. It's not the same thing, it's a job. And I think that we have, the three of us have, and probably Paul too, but I don't know them well enough to be able to say that about the other guys. But I just want to say that what George is saying is a really important function. I try to tell my students that you don't have to make a living at this in order to be able to keep making art. If you have it in your heart to make it, make it.
Amen. You're preaching.
No, that's a good. Yeah, you.
You know, I like to say I got the MFA. My wife is making the art.
Right.
You know, my wife is making the art.
But so are you.
I know. Oh, she's doing great stuff. I'm a little intimidated.
But she's doing great stuff. That's true.
Okay.
And she's doing it the right way. Anyways, so. And wait, Susan is also our newest member. And next year, that's her. And next year, she will be, if we do show, I don't know if we're going to, but I'm not pressuring you. I'd like to press you, but I won't.
Nobody.
Right. That's what I thought. But she will be with us next year. So.
I'm Bill Keyser. I was born and raised in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. From my earliest days that I can remember, I've always built things. My father was a self-employed carpenter contractor with a shop at our home. And I always had a shop at our home, separate from his. And so I was always in grade school, high school, always building things. My math scores, I guess, were pretty good. And I went to a parochial high school, and the guidance counselor said, you ought to be an engineer. So I went to Carnegie Mellon, it was Carnegie Tech in those days. Halfway through the first semester, I said to my parents, there's a fine arts building on campus, and they have architecture and sculpture and painting and music, and dance and all these things, I should be over in that building. And my parents said, stick with engineering. When you're making money at it, you'll enjoy it a lot more. And they were dead wrong. Sophomore year, I was wandering through the bookstore and I picked up a book called Contemporary Sculpture by Carolyn Gideon Welker. I still have the book and I devoured it and fell in love with sculpture. But I was in engineering. I can remember going to final exams with only the vaguest notion of what the class was all about. Somehow I got through with like a 2.03 or something, grade point average. Got a job in engineering. My mother was wrong, I hated it. If I had stuck with engineering, I would be living under a bridge somewhere. I'm convinced of it. At any rate, 6 months into my engineering job, I was taking a class at Kent State University in Kent, Ohio, and taking a jewelry making class because it was the only art class that I was really qualified to take. It was offered at that time. And got talking to my instructor, and he said, you ought to look at this place in RIT called the, in Rochester, called the School for American Crafts. I came up over a weekend, interviewed the, talked to the wood instructor, and most of my work had been in wood, talked to the jewelry instructor, went back, quit my job, came up to RIT, and spent 2 years ending up with an MFA in furniture design. I got a job in Ohio for a year, and halfway through the first semester, or the second semester rather, I got a phone call from Harold Brennan. He said, would you be interested in coming to RIT to teach? It took me about a millisecond to say yes, and came to RIT actually the same year Wendell Castle came. We taught together for 7 years. The rest is history. I taught there for 35 years, stopped teaching in 97, went back and took a painting class from a professor that I had always wanted to take a class from, but never could because our schedules did not coincide. Spent the following 5 or 6 years, I guess, working towards an MFA in studio art, painting and sculpture. Taking one or two classes each quarter, I wasn't in any hurry. I could really immerse myself in the classes, and ended up getting an MFA. So that's the story of my life. As far as my art these days, I sort of divide it between sculpture and painting. I like to make three-dimensional things, but I really enjoy the challenge of two dimensions. I work from what I call remnants. That is, debris, found objects, stuff that I pick up off the streets, sometimes left over from previous projects, sometimes even from some of the furniture projects that I worked on. And these kind of form a jump off point for me. I very seldom have the problem of facing a blank canvas and not knowing what to do. There's always some remnant that's in the back of my mind that I can uses a jump-off point. They don't find their way, especially in the painting, they don't find their way literally all the time. But there's a kernel of something that I originally saw. I like to surprise myself. And I like being surprised by things that are left over after a particular process has taken place. For instance, if I'm scissoring a shape from paper, when I'm done done with the thing that I intended to cut, I look at what's left on the table, and many times it's a lot more interesting than that thing that I thought I was going to make. Same with a bandsaw. When I was making furniture, you know, you work for 2 weeks, a month and a half on a piece or a group of furniture, and I deliver it and come back from delivering it and clean up the shop, you know? And I'd look around the shop and the stuff that was laying around the bandsaw was a hell of a lot more interesting than the piece that I had just, or pieces that I had just delivered. And so I came to the conclusion that I wanted to try to, when I was doing anything, try to keep one eye on what I was doing and the other eye on what the potential might be for what was left over, for what was suggested by the piece I was working on. And so I kind of go from one piece to the next. Sometimes I work in series, sometimes I just do individual pieces. So that's basically what I have to say, I guess.
Thank you.
We were very fortunate that you came.
Well, I'm the new guy on the on the street as far as the Mise en Place Salon. I met Ed and Paul and George at their three-person show over at Phillips Gallery.
Yeah.
And I met George for the first time there, and he said, "You know, we get together once a week for lunch." And he said, "It's an interesting group." I said, "Are you taking any new members?"
That's exactly.
Because I've never associated with artists on a informal basis. You know, went to faculty meetings and stuff like that, but that doesn't count. Never had what I considered close friends that I felt comfortable with. And so I called George one day and I said, "Is that invitation still open?" This was about 2 years ago, I guess. And I look forward. We meet on, well, regardless of when we meet, I look forward to the day when we get together.
Right. I want to say something about Kurt, too. Kurt came back to Rochester after living in the Cape for like 19 years. And he was an institution here. And he started, when George and I started to have lunch together and then it started to grow, Kurt, who was 91 at the time, it started to really mean something really important to him. And he became, for us, you know, he just has this wealth of information and, you know, and stuff, and that I can't even explain. And the same is true with Kanji. Kanji was also not here. He lived out in, where is it?
Springwood.
Ungodly place. You know, I grew up in the country, and I'm an urban person. So to live out there, I couldn't sleep at night because it's too quiet. I got to have dogs barking and sirens and stuff. And Kanji started to come back, and he wasn't doing anything like this Van Gogh or this behind us here, Jack London. And we all just started to get together. And then Sue came, and it's like all of us have done other things in our lives. And now we have each other, and we get together once a week eating somewhere, because that's what we have left. We can eat.
I got a little more than that.
Well, we got a little more stuff. And he's the baby. He's the baby of the family. At 66, he's the baby. So we thank you all, you know, right? Thank you all for coming.
It's not a closed group. Anybody wants to drop by on Fridays at noon, we're presently meeting at Flavors of Asia.
We would love Kathy Farrell to join our group.
Yeah.
Pure Rome out of Friday.
If she's not teaching on Friday.
Expand to Rome.
And we do alter our day depending on our teaching schedule.
Depending on your teaching.
Your teaching.
Yeah, my teaching.
Yeah, everything that
hell with the rest of the world.
It all revolves around the heater. My schedule changes constantly. So we were meeting on Tuesday, but we can't do that anymore because I'm teaching on Tuesday, so we're meeting on Friday. At Flavors of Asia.